Randy. Thanks so much for joining us today for Hoya Gateway's virtual Power Lunch interview. We're excited to ask questions from Georgetown students to learn more about your career. A little bit about Randy before we get started. Randy has spent nearly two decades helping clients build and manage their businesses. In 2018, he founded Keen Advisors, a client-centric firm designed to help founders and operators capitalize on his experience and expertise in finance, sales management, and strategic planning to grow their businesses through thoughtful collaboration. Randy is also co-founder of Quointec, a regtech company that designs and builds systems that automate the delivery of legal advice and creates custom compliance solutions. Through collaboration with expert service partners, Quointec leverages new technologies and innovative approaches that are rapidly changing the marketplace to automate legal advice. In other words, Quointec is building the robot lawyers. Through his various volunteer efforts, Randy also supports entrepreneurship and innovation. He sits on the board of directors of the Chicago Public Library Foundation, Urban Initiatives, and ACCION Chicago, a community-focused micro-lender. He is a board member for FinTEx, a nonprofit member-driven community of the leading FinTech and financial services companies within Chicago and the broader Midwest. Randy volunteers as a mentor for Startupbootcamp NYC, an industry-focused startup accelerator program targeting fintech companies. And now we'll dive right into questions. Randy, what experiences at Georgetown inspired your entrepreneurial spirit?
Well, thanks. First, thanks for having me, Jihad. This is a great opportunity to reach out to alums and reconnect with the university. Looking back at Georgetown, there were several things, experiences that I had that really helped me embrace the idea of building and running organizations. First and foremost, I was very involved with the Georgetown Program Board. So the Program Board is the organization on campus that organized, at least when I was there, all the concerts, comedy events, our the ongoing films that we were putting on. And just in general, we had a ton of activities, and the idea was to create social cultural experiences for the students to engage with, to take their mind off of school. I started off as a volunteer, and eventually by my senior year, I was the chair of the program board. That was, I think in hindsight, probably one of the most entrepreneurial experiences that I had that really gave me the bug for being able to program and build and execute on events that started off as ideas. And I have so many great memories on campus, but the one that I'll kind of jump on is when I was in school, Billy Joel was doing a tour, and he was actually looking for smaller venues. I was lucky enough to work with a classmate named Justin Bear at the time, who was our concerts chair, and he found this out, and we got the opportunity to put Billy Joel in Gaston Hall. The challenge of it was a really short time frame to both make the request to get him on campus, make the case for Georgetown, but then obviously Gaston Hall is a special place. And so for us, it was a matter of getting the university on board and supporting it. Long story short, we ended up pulling it off. It was one of the most magical moments that I had on campus, but really a telling story of where what can happen when we put the right team together, focus on the right idea. And I didn't realize it then. I ended up working in corporate for almost two decades after I graduated. But the idea of putting on something from scratch or organizing something towards a vision was something that really came through to me on campus. And in hindsight, was just a sign of what I really enjoyed to do. It's what I missed the most, and that's why ultimately why I became an entrepreneur. It's what I missed the most was really kind of being able to work with fellow students and put together events that were really neat, very similar to the entrepreneurial journey where you're working with the right team and, you know, coming up, thinking through, you know, what is the business plan? What resources do we need to put to execute against it? How do we align those resources? How do we do it efficiently? And then how do you execute? Again, all those lessons were things that I was able to pick up on campus. There were a lot of other really neat experiences. Another one was Georgetown Day. Students today take Georgetown Day as a very big celebration, but I was part of the original group that was formulated the first ever Georgetown Day. It came from, and again, just to talk about the analogies between things you do on campus and other stories that occur, talking about, you know, what the life is like of an entrepreneur. We had gone through a really tough year that year on campus with some pretty tough student events and events that happened on campus. And we really were trying to find a way to get the community to rally together around issues that were critical to the organization and to the community of Georgetown. Long story short, the concept of Georgetown Day was something we put together. Provost Dorothy Brown at the time was able to garner the resources from the university, and we put on our first ever Georgetown Day. There's a great video out on YouTube, I think you could find it, of kind of what happens. It features me being woken up at like 2 a.m. or 3 a.m. to go blow up balloons. But again, to go back to what helped me get excited about entrepreneurship or what experiences I had. It started with that. The problem was we needed to build community or remind ourselves of what made our community special. And we got the right group of people together, put a plan together, and created a moment that now, my understanding, has been going on for almost 2 decades, which is wild to think about. The next spring would probably be the 20-year anniversary of Georgetown Day. You know, I had a lot of other moments, but those are the two that jump out.
So Randy, this student asked, what can I do as a student to develop my own path in entrepreneurship?
So I would say this, anytime that people ask me or bring up the topic of entrepreneurship, my first comment is that luckily enough, we live in an environment where determining your own path and creating your own career or your own business is something that's now seen as not just something that's exciting, but also something that's like a true career path. And when I was graduating, entrepreneurship was not talked about as like a goal or even a class or, well, there were classes, but there was less of a structured study around it. There's a lot of allure to entrepreneurship, but it is not for everyone. So I would say that the first thing you should do is really speak to entrepreneurs and ask them their stories, get to know people. As a student, you have access to the entire network of alums. I know I respond pretty quickly when students reach out. May not get in front of me and may not connect with them right away, but we find the time as alums to talk to them. My first response is you should reach out to alums that are living that lifestyle. Two, you should be ready for a career of a lot of uncertainty. And when you're in entrepreneurship, I mean, I know for a fact people that have jumped off right before COVID to start a venture and just the timing wasn't right. The people were great. There was money involved in the opportunities, but the environment just didn't allow the business to succeed. So I think number one, you got to talk to the people that are living in. Number two, you have the appetite for that risk. But then on a practical matter, go find projects. As a student today, you can just reach out to tons of people. DC is creating a tremendous startup ecosystem and founder network. And I know for a fact, as I speak to many people in that market a lot, and there is no lack of a need for talent to people that work on projects. I know that I took on volunteers with my regtech startup this summer from Georgetown. If you really want to live that lifestyle, and go ahead and go volunteer, go think about what your skill set is and ask questions about where you can apply your skill set to help. Go find connections. I think that you're gonna be surprised that alums are really interested in helping with that.
Thank you so much for sharing that. The next question we have here is, what stands out as a pivotal moment in your career that led you to where you are?
Pivotal moment in my career? That's a good question. I would say all of my work in corporate was surrounding the founder and the entrepreneur. And so there's not one, there's a lot of micro moments. And what I would say that it's when I realized early in my career as a banker that I was running businesses or interacting with clients in a way we were trying to help them solve problems, I was consistently drawn to the founder and their story and what their struggles were. And I didn't realize, I thought it was just because that was my job. And you don't know early in your career, I still don't know what I want to be when I grow up. I think you kind of just do the jobs that are ahead of you. And especially in this environment, you want to make sure you're trying to develop a skill set. Wait for the perfect skill set will get you burned. But I guess the first thing that I would say for me pivotally is I started listening to, about 5 or 6 years ago, I started listening to myself and saying, I care less about the company I work for and I care more about the problem I'm trying to solve. And that was just something that consistently kept ringing every time I spoke to a founder and every time that I would sit there and spend a dinner or a lunch or a meeting and we'd spend 7 minutes speaking about the work part that we're solving a problem for and then 53 minutes talking about how they're having challenges managing their talent or they're really disappointed in how a certain client's reacted to their product. Those are the problems I always found drew me to them. So it's a bunch of little moments that I would say I had where I found myself continuously in these conversations. And that's what really drove me and pulled me into making the decision that I ultimately was going to work for myself is that those problems are the ones that I like solving. In my career, I provided a service through the banking platforms and the companies that I work for and the platforms that I worked on. But at the end of the day, what drew me was with the problems I wanted to solve were the ones that had nothing to do with the services. And when I spoke to clients about leaving, every single one of them kept saying to me that they didn't care about where I was, that they wanted to continue working with me or stay in touch or continue to work to collaborate. They were less focused on me working as a banker and more how I helped them grow their business. And I think that's why I was able to do well in the corporate setting as well as find opportunities in private sector on my own as well.
Thank you so much for sharing that. And the next question here segues nicely in. What kind of decisions do you make in your job?
So I wear many different hats. Part of my job right now is, I run a consultancy. Keen Advisors is a consultancy. We work with clients on long-term retainer projects. That's how I pay the bills. I do long-term retainer work for clients, but really the aim of that is to help companies that I understand, that I know with executives and leaders that I know, solve a specific problem for a longer period that requires a longer period of time of planning and executing against it. So in that role, the decisions that I do day in and day out is really listening and doing research to support the decisions or help a founder or CEO think through a business decision that they have to make, doing a lot of research. And it's really more about forming the client with what the perspective is. They're running their businesses. They're focused on other day-to-day operational matters in the business. With Quointec, which is a regtech company that I co-founded with a few other great partners, problems we're facing every day is prioritizing projects. So that company creates products on a regular basis. And at any given moment, we're looking at three or four different things we want to do. And then we have to prioritize and then go get the resources, find the right partners to create the product and then execute. And then we have to go deliver it to clients. The decisions on a regular basis are what's the best in class technology that we can find? Who are the best partners? How do we design a user interface that's really friendly to the end client? Who is our end client? Those are the decisions we're making on that front. And then lastly, you mentioned FinTEx. I actually am the executive director of FinTEx as well, not just on the board, and that's a trade association. And this has been a tough year for us. So we historically, FinTEx has been focused on doing in-person events around the country at different conferences. We do local networking opportunities here in Chicago, where we really try to create community amongst companies in the FinTech space. COVID changed those decisions. We can't continue to meet each other in person. So we've been trying to figure out a way on how do we create connectivity within our community, both within Chicago and outside of it, leveraging virtual platforms that were available to us. So that is, you know, from my vantage point, on a very consistent basis, the needs change or the decisions we're making changes or the decisions we're making change. I think in part, that's why I like the work because it tackles different parts of me, right? So Quointec is a very product creation, product development business. And then you got to go out and deliver that solution to clients on a consistent basis and in a way that resonates with them. Keen is a lot more broader strategic thinking, long-term planning, really thinking about what are the real issues that are going to help the company drive growth in the next 3 to 5 years as opposed to the next, you know, 6 to 10. And then lastly, on the FinTech side, we're trying to create community. So for me, it works nicely because it touches on a lot of the things that I enjoy doing on a regular basis. But it also, for some people, it might drive them batty because my job is not specific in terms of the only thing that I do is X.
Thank you for sharing that. It sounds like there are a lot of moving parts every day. And this next question is something along those lines. So the student asked, what are the most interesting and most mundane parts of your job?
The most interesting parts of my job is that everything that I'm touching is generally greenfield, which means nobody's been there before. We're trying to create a space that has not gotten attention in the past. So I think that is really exciting. And it comes with different challenges, right? Sometimes you think that you designed this mousetrap and it's going to work and you're wrong. So I think the mundane parts of my job are testing ideas. And testing ideas in small places so that we can make big decisions. That part is not as exciting or sexy because, like anything else, a lot of the stuff ends up on the cutting board, right? And that's not as fun or exciting. It's not as neat. I think the other part of it is I work with really great people. That's one of the things that I found really motivating in my time as an entrepreneur is I choose the people that I work with now. And, you know, generally I had a great career at two great companies where I got to learn from very successful professionals who had a tremendous track record across various industries and various, and within the companies and outside of the companies. But today I'm doing a lot more deep work with people that I work with. And, you know, it's nice because it kind of matters that when somebody's kid's birthday is, that the big birthday's coming up, and being able to build real meaningful connections with those people really means a lot. So that's, I think, the most interesting part of my job is a human aspect. I think that one of the things people would probably say about me, my friends will, is that I'm always much more focused on the human element or the kind of the EQ side of things And when you get to that part, you get to know people really well personally. And that's the neat part of working for myself. I don't have to work with people I don't necessarily enjoy or that I don't like working with, and or projects that I don't get excited about.
Thank you so much for sharing that. This next question is, how are your businesses uniquely affected by macroeconomic volatility?
Well, very much so, all three of them, but in different ways. So I would say the consultancy is affected because some projects that I anticipated to happen this year because of macroeconomic conditions are just not a high priority. And at moments like these, a lot of companies really focus on how do we survive. And then those extra growth pillar or projects or those two to three other priorities that they thought were going to drive 2021 and 2022 just aren't as important. So I have to manage that, right? And have to see clients where they are and be patient. Product development side, I think it's kind of to the contrary. We have seen that COVID has pushed people to really embrace digital platforms, digital transformation, and also the macroeconomic pressures of managing costs. When you're using technology to deliver a service, particularly a service around legal and compliance, it generally is going to drive down costs. That's the value proposition for the end client. And so I've seen that conversations are just heating up a lot quicker than we thought. And as we continue to build a track record for being able to build great tools, we become the target of people wanting to collaborate more frequently with us. And so that's exciting. It also, interestingly enough, makes our portfolio of products that we're building attractive to other potential buyers or bidders. That's something that's been a new surprise for us, because I think that what larger companies, software companies are realizing is if they have the focus of the person making the software decision, consumption decision, then they have more products they can sell in. They're going to maximize the relationship. And so that's been a really big positive. Our trade association has been, that's been a really head scratcher, because we've had to, when we're dealing with large corporates, you got to justify every penny they're going to spend. And sponsors and members are a huge source of revenue for a nonprofit trade association. It is a big headwind, but I think that we will get through it stronger. And as any nonprofit can say, these are the moments that test your resiliency and your plans for the worst case. And I feel great that we have approached COVID. We've thought about it and prepared in a way that we just accelerated a plan that we had long term. And so all in different ways, but I think that tension is healthy and a reminder not to sit tight on laurels, because I lived through the crisis in 2008. I was actually in New York working at JP Morgan at the time. And I recall that one of the things that as we started going into COVID that I didn't feel was that fear that I felt in 2008. It wasn't that I didn't think that things were going to be difficult. It's just that being through cycles gave me the confidence that I knew that it would be okay. And because of the work that I do, we may be better positioned as a result of it. I think that macroeconomic conditions are really important to watch, but it's just a reminder to executives and people in decision-making positions to consistently be thinking about worst case planning scenarios. As a professional, I think if I were a student, I would just make sure that if I'm thinking about my career, there's no industry that's cyclical proof. And so you can't get it perfect, so don't overthink it. I think it's just it's a calling to continue to focus on working with people that you can learn from, exciting teams, on projects that you will find challenging and will push you to grow and develop. And with a focus around building meaningful relationships to help your career grow. Because ultimately, regardless of the cycle, if you go through those three things, particularly the last point, you have real meaningful relationships with mentors and people in your career that can help you find other opportunities. You'll find yourself more resilient to some of the trends, some of the cycles. This is a really painful cycle for corporations that are going through what they would call the house cleaning, where some people just were going to probably get cut anyway. This accelerated it. But if you are a talented person, you are finding yourself with expanded responsibility, finding yourself with more opportunities at different firms. And people really want during times like these to be around people they trust, people who they know really well. So you'll find those people calling you.
Thank you for sharing that. And we're down to the last two questions here. What can Georgetown students do to make the most of their time before they go into their careers?
Got unconventional answers here for you. First and foremost, I believe that the first thing you can do is enjoy your time on campus when you have it, and enjoy building relationships you have. Ultimately, my friends from Georgetown are people that I now reach out to for business all the time. Business advice, for collaboration, opportunities to develop and grow. And they're people that have known me and know my personality. The core of elements of who I am haven't really changed. So first and foremost is really enjoy the time there, build those relationships that you have, because you'd be surprised how 25 years from now, all of you are successful doing very different things. And some of the things you might think, and success is not just being at the top of the ladder. It takes on very many different definitions. I found myself in the last couple of weeks calling upon a fellow Hoya who is several decades older than I am. I met through the Board of Governors for a personal matter that I wanted to ask him about, something that he was an expert in. There were just questions that I had about things that I probably wouldn't feel comfortable talking to somebody brand new for the first time, but because I've known that person for so long, I knew they were a trusted source on the particular issue, and they were really helpful. So don't be shy about that, about the, making that investment. The other thing you can do is really sample a lot of different things. For me, the program board gave me exposure to the music industry, gave me exposure to the comedy industry. I was really lucky. I went to school with people, the likes of Nick Kroll, who are now on TV, Mike Birbiglia, sorry. I mean, all these folks were on campus when we were there. A lot, I took it for granted when I was on campus, but now looking back, I mean, it really is kind of neat that I got to sample all these other industries, all these other careers, while sitting at school. So I think that's really critical. And I went into it with an open mind. I think that one of the challenges that I have with a lot of students coming out of school is that they want to all be, and I'm, you know, nothing's wrong with this profession, but they all want to be investment bankers on Wall Street, right? They go into the business school, they have a set criteria, they have a plan, That's really one-dimensional work, and I don't think the future of work will look that way. So being able to experiment and sample different things and different career experiences is really great. Diversifying your internship experiences, volunteering your time, different organizations, that's the most meaningful work you're going to get from the university, because it makes the university special and unique. Lastly, I think that the way you can make the most out of your time there, in my opinion, to prepare yourself for the long term, is just realize what you don't know that you don't know. And that's really difficult, because I remember going to Georgetown at the age of 18, knowing that I knew all the answers to the world and I knew exactly what I wanted to be. And I was one of the smartest kids in the world. I find myself a couple decades later looking back and realizing how little I know about the world around me, a lot more humble about my knowledge book-wise, but also my knowledge in terms of perspective and context, eager to learn more. It's made me very curious about the world around me. And if you can really try to embrace the fact that you're there to absorb, you don't know everything, stay curious, but stay humble and really, 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 really accept that life is a learning experience. It's not just those 4 years, and it's not like you know everything at that point. That to me is really important, and it's been a big part of my life. And I think a part of the reasons I've seen success in some, in many aspects of my life, and when I've fallen short of my own expectations, it's because I felt that I've almost overplanned it or overthought it. So I would urge people to do that, to just know that you don't know everything. And you know, the older you get, the more you realize that it's harder with as you start in your career and you realize you're really bright, feel like you know all the answers. Sometimes understanding where you are in the context of a greater fabric of what the world is and how not insignificant, but how unique and how singularly that part is really critical.
Thank you for that very thoughtful answer. The last question we have here for you is, what advice do you have for Hoyas who are preparing to go into their first job? So our class of 2021 is virtual this year, but I know they are already thinking about what their first jobs are going to look like.
Yeah, so first thing you should do is call people that are doing the job. There are a lot of Hoyas that have those jobs. As you're interviewing for them, which I don't know what the interview process is going to look like, but you should reach out to alums on a regular basis to get a sense of what the real work is, understand what it is, what drives success in that role, what is it the manager is going to look for in terms of success. That's my first point, is just don't be shy about picking up the email or picking up the phone. I know people are friends with text. Send the email, but always do it by phone. You know, Zoom calls are common now, so just do that. Look people in the eye and ask them, hey, I just want to know what your day-to-day is. What would you do differently if you could start over again? Who are the people you should be looking for advice? Who are the people you should be looking to just earn their respect? I mean, just the dynamics in the office are going to create a really great environment for you. That hard work on the front end means you're going to avoid a ton of mistakes down the road. And I think that's at that stage in the career, I think that's more important. Not making mistakes that are unnecessary is probably more important than trying to find success. Second thing I would say is I grew up in a professional world where the junior person always had to be the first one in and the last one out. And I understand that sounds kind of a little old school is probably the best way to say it, but I think that it's not necessarily physically. It's really about the conceptually being the first person to do the research and provide information to the group, being the last person that's double checking the work that's being done or finding a mistake before it's the final check that's finally submitted really means a long way. So I would say last, as opposed to taking the literal definition of first one in, last one out, into the office, they take the definition, a broader one, which is more a conceptual one of how you approach, a philosophy of how you work. You're going to be the first to raise your hand for the job to do something, even if it is crappy work. You learn a lot from that work, and you earn, most importantly, a lot of respect from your peers who recognize that. It's hard to differentiate yourself in the world with the internet because a lot of the information is already out there, but the hustle is not. You can't Google hustle and like have it show up and mirror work, right? It's something that's felt. So I think that's a big component. One of the things that I think is really critical to success. And then lastly, realize that you may actually hate that job and it's probably not going to be what you do for the rest of your life. Listen, Georgetown is a liberal arts school and we're taught how to think. And I know for a fact that one of the things I appreciate most about my experience there is that in hindsight, the work that I did at school for me prepared me for an approach to life that I think has been that matched my personality and my interests. And what that has allowed me to do is to ask myself the hard questions of, am I happy? Is this what I really want to do? And I don't know the numbers on this, but you could probably, you know, Georgetown probably has some fancy stat that they can pull out or machine. But the reality is that your first job probably has very little to do with where you're going to derive your happiness from in 20 to 25 years from now and how you're going to define professional success. So happiness may not be professionally. You may be, there's a lot of other things that can make you happy that have nothing to do with work. And then on the professional side, I just think that it's you draw different things from that job, but you should not stop networking because of that. And by networking, I don't mean the cheesy, hi, my name is, I have 3 years of, it's, hey Maria, I noticed you have an interesting background. I got one of these the other day because I think you sent this note out and I got an inquiry on LinkedIn and it was more like, hey, I'm a fellow Hoya. I just want to pick your brain. Don't know much about what you do. We have time together, right? So that's the neat part about the internet today is that you can look people up and reach out to them. And the Hoya community is always open. But the reality is if something's interesting to you, reach out to them. You know, you'd be surprised. I mean, shocked. There was there's a show on Showtime that I won't reference in this webinar because I don't know that. I don't want to call unnecessary attention. But the reality is that a classmate of mine is the executive producer of the show. It's one of my favorite shows, like one of my absolute favorite shows. And I'm sitting here going, crap, look at all the talent that we have in our classes. So long story short, I think it's really keep your network alive. If there's something that you can invest in, people talk about learning how to invest early in the stock market and all that jazz. The reality is, the time you're investing as in your first job, do that job right. Do all you can to make sure that you're making the impact that you need to make there. But never give up on investing time into yourself and really building that in your network. It's the most differentiating factor outside of hustle that you have. Because we all are blessed enough to go to a school like Georgetown and build relationships with people like Georgetown, you're going to realize that, crap, all my friends are doing really cool things. Or I never realized that person had this dimension to them that is so fascinating. So, you know, it's one of the most exciting things. I hope the students really take away, if anything, that those relationships that you have, even ones that you don't because of Georgetown, are really, really amazing and impressive. I've been to the conferences in London, Berlin, Las Vegas. I go conferences every single time I go, there's a Georgetown connection. And it's really neat. It's one of the things that makes the school super special.
Well, thank you so much for sharing all of this valuable insight. I think the students will definitely get much out of it. Thanks, Randy.
No problem. Thanks for having me.